Hey, it's been a few days. Lots going on. Things and stuff here and there, this and that. Got the Allison 250 on its back end, and the only reason we can do that is because the combustor outer case is off, and so is the dome covering the protecting the turbine from heat of combustion. So anyway, it's vertical, and what I've done is I've cleaned the other case half. We'll look at that in a second. And what are we doing? Oh, okay. I did say last time we were going to take a look at the oil pump, and I'm going to show you why that's a mistake. Because the oil pump is buried deep inside the gear box or the gear case or the accessory drive case, and it's a very large gearbox with a lot of everything is inside it. But we've got the oil filter and pressure regulator assembly, which is on top of the oil pump. We can take a look inside and look at all that, which we're going to do in a second. But first of all, when I took the other compressor case half off, right there, there's the front with the bigger vanes. It's not aesthetically beautiful, but there was a large wad, it looked like, of mud on the concave surface, so sort of hidden from view. And this is the bottom. So that mud would have really, it was a piece. And if the piece was dislodged, it would have really done nasty things to the stators downstream of it. So you can see the liner, this yellow liner. Let's see if you can see all the little cracks and things in it. Let's see, there we go. Little cracks. Those cracks are all legal in terms of inspection criteria. There's no pieces missing. And oh, bit of metal fabrication next door. And they're gonna stay in there. So we're gonna reinstall this and torque it. But what we're also doing, before we get to what we're also doing, this is the cover for where the oil filter goes in. It's like a motorcycle oil filter. But it's not a paper element, it's a screen really. Well, I'm gonna go get it and show it to you. Okay, so it is a very fine mesh, very fine metal mesh. It's cleanable and reusable, never needs to be replaced, but it's really not a filter. It's a very fine metal mesh screen. So it goes in there, and we're gonna take a look inside. Actually, what we're gonna do is we're remove the whole housing here. This is the pressure regulator spring. We'll pull this off. Let's see if we can pull it off. There we go. Out it comes. It's got connections on the bottom. And we're going to light up the interior of the gearbox. Can you see in there? Let's see. Can you see in there? We're going to change the tripod right now. Get a better view. Okay, let's take a look in there. It's hard for me to do both things. Okay, so those are the ends of the lines that connect into the bottom of the housing. You're looking at the oil pump assembly. It's right there. There's actually four oil pumps in there, and it's tiny. But this here is the first gear that's driven by the compressor. Let's back up a little bit when I turn that. Okay, you can see both the big spur gear. That's the first stage of reduction. There's a small, can you see this? The compressor side of it, it's a small spur and a large one. If I turn the compressor the way that it goes, you can see stuff moving. That's the first stage of reduction, a very small gear turning a very large gear. And then there's another stage. Let's see if I can get that as well. Where is it? Ah, it's underneath. Okay, you can see the second stage of reduction. It's just this way of the first. It's down in there. Let's see. There it is. Can you see that? Second stage of reduction. Very cool. This is all the gas producer chain. So that second stage of reduction then turns the fuel pump, the compressor, turbine, regulator, the oil pumps, and the tack jenny for that stage. So that would be, you could consider that the core drive to the gearbox. All right, this is what we just looked at. This is the main gearbox, the main, it's almost like the engine block of the engine. It's the biggest part of the engine. So the filter housing and pressure regulator fits on top and slides down in, and it connects to, via these two O-ring passages, to these lines. And they're actually illustrated here, and sort of the dotted. Anyway, that's the easy part to get out. And the reason that we're not looking at the oil pump is, like I showed you, it's underneath all that. But we can take a look at what makes up the oil pump assembly. So, and you'll see that, just a second. All right, here's the oil pump assembly. The first inlet has one scavenge pump, and then there's two scavenge pumps on this stage, I guess, and the pressure pump. Sorry, this is the pressure pump, this is a scavenge pump, and this is two scavenge pumps. So a total of four oil pumps in a tiny little ice cream sandwich type thing, ice cream sandwich size thing. And so for this diagram, figure six, this is gonna be figure six. Most importantly, make sure you're looking at the proper figure or diagram. And you'll notice there's one, two, three, four, five pages of listings of individual parts. And a lot of times there's 001, 001, 001, 001. There are many different alternates for the parts. So funny thing, first thing you learn about, well, any engine in particular, but in particular, in extra particularity, gas turbine engines and aircraft engines, it's not more complicated than you thought. It's way more complicated than you thought. So there we are at jet school. Hang on, I got to sneeze here. Oh. So there we are at jet school in our first, I think it's our first week, or maybe it's our second week after the introductions and all the other stuff like that, the introductory stuff. So we're gonna go take a rear bearing out of a spay. So there's all the guys in the class going over there. They think, you know, they're just gonna take the rear bearing out. So they go get the manuals and they wanna see the picture and they wanna see the tool and they wanna see the instructions on how to take out the rear bearing. Okay, so the manual is not the manual. The manual is several books this big. There, that's the overhaul manual for the spay. And there's a list of tools on page 98 of book one. There's a list of illustrations of tools on page 785 of book nine. And then there's the procedures for the rear bearing, several different versions of which are used, and they're going to be in section 16 of book 5. So you see all these guys, and I was one of them, people, all these students, there's women that do this too, trundling on up to the bookshelf, and it's like watching a slow motion train wreck, because this book's open, that book's open, scratching heads, puzzling, flipping through pages. It takes half the day just to figure out where you are in the book to even start to read the instructions. And that's why many of the exercises in the school are to make sure that you read and understand the instructions, all 98 of them, or all 116, and then you do them in that order. Because if you don't do them in the order, you can damage some very expensive stuff and basically fail. Anyway, it's funny. So we have the overhaul manual and we have the illustrated parts catalog. What I just showed you was the illustrated parts catalog. It doesn't tell you what to do. It just shows you what the parts are, every last little part, and every last little part has a part number. And what you do is you read the procedure in the overhaul manual, and then when you want to put it back together, you make sure you have all the right parts and you check the parts by part number with the IPC. And if the part number is the same, you know you have the right part. If the part number is different, You have to make sure if it's wrong or you have an alternate. And often there are many alternates and they can be in different books even. So I went into that basically because there's a lot of extra pages. And so one of the reasons a paper copy is better than a PDF is if you're looking at a diagram and it says number 36, number 36 could be 16, 17, 20 pages further through the book or through the PDF to find what it is. You know, you're looking at a number and a diagram and what's that thing? And anyway, sometimes the paper copy is better, sometimes it's not. So what we're going to do, we've got to come to a decision here. The reason I've been reading the overhaul manual, hang on. All right, this is the overhaul manual for the C20, not the C18, but close enough. So compressor assembly description. What we want to do is we want to find out if the scroll, sorry, if the centrifugal compressor element scroll can be removed. Actually, what do I want to find out? Hang on, I'll show you. So this housing is, they call it the scroll. It's magnesium alloy, so it's highly susceptible to corrosion. The paint is coming off. We want to repaint it. Now, the overhaul manual describes how to take the engine completely apart, to take every piece apart and inspect it and rebuild it from scratch. What we're hoping to do, well, we have two choices. We can mask off everything, mask off the interior, mask off the gearbox, and we can paint this in place, which is a second-rate shortcut, a third-rate shortcut. But we're trying to figure out if we can pull off a second-rate shortcut, which is to remove the entire assembly module, the compressor module, and lift it off the engine. And that way we're freed from the gearbox. We could probably paint the gearbox as well and paint this a separate color. The only problem with that is not an approved procedure. The way that it's done properly is you disassemble everything, and so then you've got the compressor scroll as a single casting and the gearbox cases as separate castings. They can be beautifully stripped and painted and everything is just fantastic. It's like new. We're hoping to avoid a full overhaul because, like I said, this is an after-hours project for fun. So I'm hoping, and you Allison 250 experts out there, you can please chime in and help me. I'm reading the manual. The manual is not designed for shortcuts, so they don't tell you if you can remove the whole assembly and leave it the way it is, mask this off, and paint the scroll. Or if you can remove the whole assembly and remove the scroll because the bolts come in through the back. What we want to do is to paint the scroll and put it back. We don't want to do anything else. So if you're a Rolls-Royce 250 or Allison 250 technician with experience and done this before, let me know. Can I do that? I don't want to remove this yet until I'm sure that I don't need the alignment fixture to put it back together because we don't have the alignment fixture. We don't have any factory tooling. So I'm going to put the compressor back together and I'm hoping that I'll get some answers. If we have to, we will basically mask off in situ as best we can and then we're gonna scrub off and brush off just the compressor scroll and we're gonna paint it to halt the corrosion that's already there. And then we'll probably do the same thing with the gearbox because it's got some patches, which I'll show you right now. Okay, if you look right there, we've got the gearbox housing and this is bare metal here. The paint's flaked off and this is magnesium alloy. It hasn't been scraped off with a brush, but it's very susceptible to corrosion. And we just can't leave it like this because it's actually going to be in a wet environment, not salt water, but water, but still really, it needs to be painted. It would be nice to take the whole thing apart and have this as one single piece, paint it beautifully and overhaul it, but that is much, much more work than what we really want to do. But we don't want to just leave it bare. So that's what we're trying to do here. All right, so you can see the engine here is on the back end of the turbine case, and the turbines are just inside this flange, and so it sits squarely on that flange. And this is connected to the combustor case, and the combustion gases go through the annulus of the turbine nozzle into the turbine blades, and they turn the turbine. But they're protected from the bearing, that the rear support of the turbine, by this dual layer heat shield, which is right in the path of the exhaust gases, very hot. And that's why it's got some crescent-shaped welds here. So it's two layers of high-temperature steel. Might even be Inconel. It feels very, very stiff. But anyway, this is what protects the bearing housing. And the bearing housing actually has a cap on it. So there's one, two, three layers of steel between the exhaust gases and the bearing. And the bearing housing is flushed with fresh oil, and the oil is scavenged away quickly, and the oil is good for up to 500 degrees Fahrenheit. So that's how the bearing is protected from heat, several layers of metal, and cooling air and oil. Anyway, I thought I'd show you that. It looks a lot like the base of a Apollo space capsule. Yeah, I think so. Anyway, progress continues at a slow pace. We're getting there. We're trying to avoid as much major procedural content as possible so that we can get this on the road. And if we can remove the entire compressor module just as a module, that'd be great, because then we can take the scroll off and we can paint it basically by itself. But I'm not an experienced 250 technician, and as I said, the overhaul manual does not include quick and dirty shortcuts, because that's not how it's done. That is not how it's done. So if you know for sure, I would appreciate some input, and that'd be really cool. All right. So the bottom compressor case half was cleaned with water-based, basically soap and water, a bit of brushing. Went a lot quicker than the other case half. And it's time to go back on. So, another little bit of a trick here, just to get it in place. There we go. Everything should go together nicely with no force. I like that. Everything's beautiful. Now it's a matter of putting the fasteners back in. And, we'll take a look at a detail here. Now, I don't know if you noticed, but when I took this thing apart, the bolts for the front bearing housing were this way. Now, aviation tradition, way back from the Wright brothers until now, is bolts go inward, down, and aft. In other words, they go this way. So I changed over here. I changed the front bearing housing bolts from being what I call backwards, not necessarily backwards. I went from that way to this way. I think it looks better. So that's what we're going to do. Functionally, it doesn't really matter. I don't think functionally it's going to matter, but I think it aesthetically, I like the way it looks better. And that's the way it's going. Oh, I should show you the data tag that was on the compressor assembly. So let's just take a look at that as well. So right here, actually in that position, is this fabulous stainless steel tag. See if I can get this thing to focus on it. Yeah. So it says compressor assembly. It doesn't say compressor module, but I'm hopeful that that means the whole thing comes off as one. Now, when we were in turbine engine school, it wasn't an Allison 250 course, it was a turbine engine course, so we didn't cover this quick and dirty shortcut. So I'm asking the Allison 250 guys out there, can I just... Okay, right down here you can see there's a steel plate on the back, and there's a stud sticking up with a nut and a washer. These are for mounting a tack generator, they're part of the gear case. But this thing, there's five of these around the back, around the whole compressor module, which I'm going to call it. If I undo all of these, can I lift this thing, the whole thing, the entire compressor, off? The book doesn't tell me whether or not it's just a spline or if there's an inner bearing race on the shaft that's going to be caught in a what they call the 2.5 bearing. So if it does come off as one unit, that would be fantastic. If it doesn't, we'll work around it. But until I find out for sure, I'm following the ever successful practical procedure of, if you don't know for sure, don't do anything until you find out for sure, because you don't want to cause a whole lot more work and expense for yourself than you wanted to. So that's what we're doing. I've got another manual I'm going to read and I'm going to study to see if I can do that. I think I can, but I'm not going to gamble, not right now. We'll have to have a meeting about it, have an executive decision, and then go for it, because it's only 5 bolts. Nuts, actually. And, well, one of them is a little difficult. Let me show you that one. If you look here, that bolt, that's actually a bolt right there, you'll notice that there's no room for anything to get on that. So that's a bit of concern. It's probably going to be a highly customized wrench, even cut into the shape of a C to grab that. But I'm guessing it's fairly tight. It's a 12 point. It's going to be interesting. And there's not even a sheet of paper's worth of clearance. The shadow makes it look like there's more, but there isn't. So, interesting. See, here is one of the fancy, super fancy, those guys. Aviation wrenches, 5/16. That's a 5/16 bolt. And it will not accommodate. It won't go into that gap. The compressor scroll is too close. Now, I don't want to grind this wrench, but I might take another box end wrench and grind it so it's paper thin in one section so it'll get around there. Maybe, but right now that's not going to do it. That's not going to do it. It won't fit in that gap. That's the only sticking point. Anyway, so this is a very popular, highly successful engine. There's thousands of them out there. There's many guys and girls working on them. So I'm asking for your help. Can I do that? And I thank you in advance for your answer. Thanks for watching.